हेलो। सो यस्टरडे वी हैव सीन अबाउट क्लासिफिकेशन ट्रीज एंड रिग्रेशन ट्रीज। सो टुडे विल कंटिन्यू दैट डिस्कशन। जस्ट टू रिवाइज, व्हाट हैपन्स इन क्लासिफिकेशन एंड रिग्रेशन ट्रीज इज बेसिकली अ रिकर्सिव बाइनरी पार्टीशन। ओके, सो व्हाट डू आई मीन बाय रिकर्सिव बाइनरी पार्टीशन? इफ सपोज आई हैव ओनली टू वेरिएबल्स x1 एंड x2, and let us say the total range in my data for x1 is say this much, and so from here to here, and for x2 it is from here to here, then my data is kind of arranged in the form of a rectangle. So at every step we do recursive partition. Recursive partition means, and binary partition. So at every step we divide the data into two parts only. We never divide into more than two parts. So maybe the first partition is on the basis of say x2, so x2 less than b1 say, so this is say b1, so x2 less than b1 is this part, and x2 greater than b1 is this part. We can consider equality here. At the next step now, each of these two parts is going to get divided further. So maybe for this region, suppose the division is on the basis of x1, and this is suppose a1, okay, then so this is suppose point a1, so for this part my division happened as x1 less than or equal to a1 and x1 greater than a1, and maybe for this part division again happened on the basis of x2, so I may get something like this. So this is say b2, so I have x2 less than or equal to b2 and x2 greater than b2 here. Then I may further have some a2 here and some a3 here. So if I want to draw this in the form of a tree, my first partition was on the basis of x2, so this was my root node. Then we made it x2 less than or equal to b1 and x2 greater than b1. This is my first partition. In the x2 greater than b1 part, that is the top part, the next partition was on the basis of x1. So here the next partition is on the basis of x1, so x1 less than or equal to a1 and x1 greater than a1. These are my further nodes. Whereas in the x2 less than or equal to b1 part, that is this down part, we said that the division is again first on the basis of x2, that is this. So this may be x2 less than or equal to b2 and x2 greater than b2, and then in each of these now the division is on the basis of, so a2 was here, so let me highlight it. So we had said that next division was on the basis of a2 and a3. Okay, so in x2 greater than b2 part, the division is on the basis of a2, so here I would have x1 less than or equal to a2 and x1 greater than a2 as one division, and in x2 less than or equal to b2 part, that is this, the division is on the basis of a3. So my division is x1 less than or equal to a3, x1 greater than a3. Okay, so this is how the tree and the corresponding binary partition looks like. Binary because at every step we are having exactly two branches. We never have more than two branches. And it is recursive because we are further splitting the same node. So whatever node we get, we go on splitting it further and further. Hence it is called as recursive binary partition. So what we should remember is, we always get a rectangular type of structure. We would never get something like this. Okay, some such strange things. So non-rectangular shapes we will never get via recursive binary partition. Okay, here visualizing things was easy because I am considering only two predictors, x1 and x2. But of course that need not be the case in the data. You can have multiple predictors, let's say x1, x2, xp. So what you get would be kind of p-dimensional rectangles. Okay, so each node would be basically be denoted by some p-dimensional rectangles. Okay, in fact you can characterize this every leaf node in terms of whatever has happened to it. So in this node What is the value of x1? x1 is less than a3 and x2 is less than b2. So that becomes a characteristic of this leaf node. Similarly, you can characterize every leaf node. Okay, so as we mentioned, the first node, the top node is called as root node, and the bottom nodes are called as leaf nodes. Okay, so we do this recursive binary partition. Now at every step, how do we decide the splitting criterion? That is a key question. How do we decide the splitting criterion at every step? So this is done via what is known as greedy algorithm. What is a greedy algorithm? As the name suggests, the algorithm is greedy. Greedy means it just looks for the immediate benefit. It doesn't look for the long-term benefit. It's one of the important algorithms in operation research or optimization. In fact, the Google Maps also uses greedy algorithm. Okay. So at every point, it decides best route for the next step of journey. Okay. So in trees, how does this greedy algorithm work? So suppose I have some node. This need not be a root node. This is some node. And now I want to split this node into two. That is my job. Okay. So let me call these as, this is R1 and this is R2. My job is to decide the splitting criterion. So when I say splitting criterion, I have to decide two things. The variable as well as the threshold. So for the sake of convenience, let us talk in terms of only the continuous variables, and let us assume that my response is also continuous. That is, I'm talking about the regression tree. Okay. So at every split, I have to actually decide two things to quantify that split. What should be the variable on the basis of which the split should happen, and the threshold. So if I have, say, x1, x2, xp, I have to choose variable number. Let me denote it by, say, j. And I have to choose s as the splitting threshold. Okay. What do I mean by this? My split is supposed on the basis of xj greater than s on this side and xj less than or equal to s on this side. So the job of the algorithm is to pick up j and s in some sense of optimal way. Okay, so what do I mean by optimal way? So as I said, here the trees would be actually grown with the help of greedy algorithm. So greedy algorithm means we would see what is optimal at this particular step. We wouldn't worry about what would happen in future. We won't do any long-term planning. Just at this step, what is best? Now, best in what sense? What is our job? Our final job is to do prediction. So, best for me implies good predictions. Okay. How do we predict? We know that if finally an observation lands here, the prediction is actually mean of the responses of observations which are already here. Let me call that mean as R1 hat and this as R2 hat. So what is R1 hat? R1 hat is mean of the responses of the observations in R1. When I say observation, I of course mean training observations, because only for them you know the mean, you know the response. Okay, so R1 hat is the mean of the responses of observations in R1, and similarly R2 hat. So in general, I can write Ri hat is mean of the responses of the observations in Ri. Now, when would I say my prediction is good? If it is accurate in some sense. So if I want to compute some sort of training error, what would I do? I can compute summation yi minus r1 hat square for every I, for I such that the ith observation oi is in R1. Okay. don't get confused by the notation. What I'm trying to say is, for every observation here, I would try to compute square deviation from the prediction, r1 hat. Okay, so yi minus r1 hat. And I need to consider those i's for which observation is in r1. Okay, similarly, I can compute for r2. So yi minus r2 hat square, this is for those i's for which oi is in r2. Okay, so this is kind of total prediction error for training data. Okay, so what does the algorithm do? At every point, it computes this total prediction error, of course, on the basis of training data, because while fitting the algorithm, we are going to use only the training data. Now, for every j and s, I'll get a different value of this error. Are you following it? Because if I change my j or if I change my s, my split is going to be different. So my observations would be divided on a different basis. Okay. So this total error is actually the function of j as well as s. Okay. Total error is function of j as well as s. Now what we do is, we minimize this over j and s. So find minimum over j and s. Ideally, I would say find arg mean, means find that value of argument for which this is minimum, that is, find that value of j and s for which this error is minimum, and that becomes your optimal splitting criterion. Okay, so we choose that j and s for which the split is in some sense best. So it basically minimizes the prediction error. Let us take one easy example. Suppose I have x1, x2, and x1 is say age, x2 is height, and suppose using age and height, my response variable is suppose weight. So on the basis of age and height, suppose I want to predict weight, and let me say I have 5 observations in that node. So let me list those observations. So ages are suppose 15, 21, 18, 33, and 41. Okay. And x2 is height. So height is suppose, let me consider the height in centimeters. So this is suppose 153, 158, 161, 149, and let us say 155. Okay, and the weights now. So suppose for this person the weight is 55, for this person it is 62, 65, 53, and let us say 57. These are weights. So what I have to do for the first split, I have to choose the split on the basis of j as well as s. So, suppose I consider x1, what are the possible splitting values? So, let me arrange the values in ascending order. So, 15, 18, 21, 33, 41. So, if I consider any splitting value between 15 to 18, I am going to get exact same partition. Similarly, if I consider any splitting value between 18 to 21, I am going to get exact same partition, and so on. Okay. So, if I split on the basis of say 16, what happens? So if I consider s equal to 16 and j equal to 1, then I am going to get o1 in first class and o2, o3, o4, o5. If you want, we can give them numbers here. It's actually clear, but still. So this is my o1 first observation, second, third, fourth, and fifth. So, O2, O3, O4, O5 are in second class. So, what I'll do is error sum of squares. So, if I have only one observation here, error would of course be 0. Here, I have to take mean weight for these 4. So, mean weight of these 4 values. So, I have 53, 57, 62, 65. So, 237 by 4. So how I'll compute error is 62 minus 237 by 4 whole square plus 65 minus 237 by 4 whole square plus 53 minus 237 by 4 whole square plus 57 minus 237 by 4 whole square. Okay, so this becomes my error, and because the first error is 0, the total error is only this much for this particular split. Now I can consider j equal to 1 and s equal to 19. In that case my O1 and O3 would be in first left hand side node, because for them x1 is less than 19. So O1 and O3 would be here, and O2, O4, O5 would be here. So for O1 and O3, the response values are 55 and 65. So the average is 60. So the error would be 55 minus 60 whole square plus 65 minus 60 whole square. This is error coming from this part. And from this part, O2, O4, O5, what is my error? O2 is 62, response for O2 is 62, 53, 57. So 53, 57 and 62. So 172 by 3. That is my prediction. Okay. So 53 minus 172 by 3 whole square plus 57 minus 172 by 3 whole square plus 62 minus 172 by 3 whole square. This is error for this part. So total error would be addition of these two quantities. So that would be my error for j equal to 1, s equal to 19. In this way, I can evaluate error for every j and s pair, and then I'll choose that js pair for which this error is minimum. Okay, this exercise we did for splitting one node into two parts. Of course, when you grow a tree, you have to do this for every node. So it is computationally pretty extensive exercise, but nowadays we have advanced computers and there are algorithms which would accelerate this process. Okay, is the concept clear how the split is obtained? I am talking in terms of regression. How would it happen in terms of classification? We would deal with it a bit later, because generally in regression we focus on square error, so things are okay. In classification there are different types of errors that one can choose, so we would study that a bit later. Okay, now so we go on doing this and we go on growing a tree. So when do we stop? That is the next question. When do we stop? So yesterday I think we discussed that there are different criteria on the basis of which we can stop. First is if the node becomes pure node, means if y value becomes constant in that entire node, then of course we stop. There is no point in splitting it further. Second is 5 observations in the node. Or third is 5% of the observations in each node. At most 5% of the observations in each node. But all these are kind of thumb rule like criterion. What happens if I grow a tree which is too long, or what happens if I grow a tree which is too short? Okay, so a very long tree, when I say a very long tree, it means number of nodes is high. You go on splitting for a long time, so number of nodes is high. And a very short tree means number of nodes is low. Okay, so if number of nodes is high, means if the tree is very long, it is kind of like a very flexible model. Okay, we have discussed flexibility earlier. So you grow a tree very high means in every node you have very few observations. As a result, your predictions for training data would be quite accurate. So your training error would be very low. But it sometimes may mean overfitting. Okay. Also, overfitting would mean that the tree is not robust. What do I mean by tree not being robust? Even if I change one or two observations, the tree structure may get affected quite significantly. Okay. So this happens when there is overfitting. We have seen in the case of regression how it is easy to see the change when you change only one or two observations. On the other hand, if my tree is very short, means in every leaf node there are too many observations, then what I am doing is I am approximating all these observations by one single value, so my bias in prediction would be very high. Okay, but at the same time this would mean that the tree won't change even if I change one or two observations here and there. So the tree would be quite robust, so the variance would be low. Here variance would be high, bias would be low in the earlier case. Okay, so again the job is identifying a point where there is a trade-off between bias and variance. Too high variance or too high bias. You don't want bias or variance either to be high. So how do you proceed? So in such a scenario, there is a concept called pruning of a tree. Okay, it is also known as cost complexity pruning or weakest link pruning. As the word suggests, pruning is cutting off the branches. Okay, so what do you do here? You first grow a complete tree. Okay, you don't stop initially. First you grow a complete tree and then prune weak branches. Means you cut off some of the branches. It is slightly similar to what we used to do in clustering. So we would first divide, let us say if you are going by agglomerative clustering. So initially every observation is in one, in its own cluster. And we go on joining them till everything is together. But then after getting the dendrogram, we cut at some intermediate point to get different clusters. So here we are going to do exactly same thing. So if I have already grown a big tree, okay, something like this, then I first initially grow the entire tree, I don't stop while growing the tree, and then later we prune off some of the branches. So maybe this is not required, so we prune off this branch. Okay, first of all, why to grow an entire tree and then prune back? Why not just stop at the initial thing? The reason is that we are using greedy algorithm. Because we are using greedy algorithm, at every step we are focusing on the immediate outcome. We don't know what happens in future. So even if this particular outcome doesn't look that great, in future it may be useful. Greedy algorithm doesn't see that. So what we do is we first grow an entire tree and then decide that okay, this branch doesn't look much useful, so let us prune it off. Okay, and how do you decide whether a branch looks useful or not? Again, it would be in terms of change in kind of mean squared error or within group sum of squares, something like that. So we know that from here to here, there would be some decrease in error sum of squares. Because here I was using a common predictor for all these guys. Now I am using a different y-hat for these people and different y-hat for these people. So I would be slightly improving my predictions. So we would prune those branches where no significant reduction occurs in error sum of squares. Okay. No significant reduction occurs in error sum of squares. So those branches we would prune. In that sense, it is called as weakest link pruning. Okay. As I said, it is also called as cost complexity pruning. So cost complexity pruning in what sense? So you define some sort of cost associated with each tree. For defining that cost, first we need error sum of square in each leaf node. Okay. So let us define average error sum of square in average per observation error sum of square in first leaf node as 1 upon n1 sum over I going from 1 to n1 yi minus r1 hat square. So r1 hat is the prediction for every observation in that node, that is average over all observations, and I am, for the sake of convenience, I am assuming that the observations in first node are numbered as 1 to up to n1 and so on. So in general I have em hat, nm hat, nm, sorry, nm. Okay, so this is basically same as sum over I such that y is in rm. Okay, y is in rm. So we have average, like per observation error sum of square for each leaf node. Then we define cost as a function of some alpha. It is defined as total error of this type. So sum over m going from 1 to mod t, okay, em hat into nm. So total error for every node, and mod t is the total number of nodes in that tree, including leaf node, root node, everything. Total number of nodes in a tree. So this plus alpha mod t. So this alpha is kind of a penalty factor. So what we are defining as a cost is the error component plus a penalty component. The penalty is based on the basis of length of the tree. So alpha is always positive. So it means that for a longer tree, this term would be higher. And of course, we want to minimize this C alpha. So we choose tree in such a way that this C alpha can be minimized. So if alpha is large, then the penalty component has very high importance. As a result, we would tend to choose a smaller tree. Whereas if alpha is zero, then penalty factor has no importance. So I would take an entire tree without pruning. Is it okay? Getting what I'm trying to say? So this is what we do. We choose alpha, and now corresponding to that alpha, we would get some tree which is in some sense optimal. So we would study this in slightly more detail in the next lecture. For today, I will stop here. Thank you.